So here, we're going to focus on a new type of loop, the for loop. A for loop is used for iterating over a sequence or a collection of items, such as a list, set, tuple, or dictionary. You can also iterate through strings, where each character is considered as an item as well. Another thing you can do is loop through a set of code a specified number of times. So looping is a good example of the DRY principle, which is don't repeat yourself, D-R-Y, because you don't have to rewrite a piece of code multiple times. Instead, you can just loop over it. So let's see the basic syntax of a for loop in Python. First, we use a for keyword, and then we use a placeholder that will take the value of each element in the sequence in a given iteration. We can use the placeholder as a variable inside the loop, and it will take a different value at each iteration. Then we use the keyword in, which indicates the placeholder variable will take the values in that sequence. And sequence refers to a collection of items over which we want to perform the looping. And don't forget to add the colon, because this is a really common error when you're starting to use these. So finally, we include the set of code that we want to repeat until the sequence runs out of items to loop through. And that goes inside the body here, indented on the line below where we've got the colon. So everything's easy to understand if we see a practical example. And in this example, the placeholder is the language and the sequence is coding languages. In each iteration, the value of language changes. And at each loop, language takes the value of each item in that coding languages list. And it will first take the value of Python, and then Java, and then so on and so forth. The same way that you can iterate through loops, you can also iterate through dictionaries. So by default, if we try to loop over a dictionary, the placeholder will take the value of the keys. You can see here the output only prints the name of the programming languages. And that's because it corresponds to the key being the value which the placeholder takes on if we just iterate through a dictionary like we're showing here. So right there, we've seen how to access the keys as a placeholder. So we already know how to access the values corresponding to each key in a dictionary. That's by indexing the dictionary with that key. So given that we've got this loop, which gives us the key in each iteration, we can simply index the dictionary using that key. But that way really isn't very Pythonic. There's a much cleaner way to do that, and that's using the items method of a dictionary. So the items method, remember, returns a list of tuples where each tuple has two items, key and a value. So here, if we iterate through the dictionary's items method, the call of that, we're gonna get a tuple back and we can unpack that into these variables I've got here, k and v, which represent the key and the value, the first and second item in that tuple. For loops are also used to loop through a set of code a specified number of times. And to do that, Python's got a special inbuilt function called range. Range, when given a number as an argument, returns an immutable sequence of numbers. If we print it here, you can see just by itself, it doesn't provide much information. It's basically just a range of numbers of as many as you specified in the argument. But if you cast it to a list, you can see its contents just contains those integers. So the range type has more arguments than the final number, and sometimes you might forget. I don't expect you to remember that, so just Google it. So let's take a look here. I'm going to Google for Python range. So I'm going to scroll down, and here you can see I found the official docs on Python.org. So I'll click that, and there's a lot of stuff in here. So let me just Control F for the range. Say I know the function name, I just don't know how to use it. Let's enter through a few of these options. All right, so I can see it being used here. Is this the documentation though? I don't think so. All right, this looks more like it. So the range type, here we go. Here's an example. So you can see range of 10 like this gives me, as we've seen, a list of 10 different items, but it can also take in two arguments. Let's have a look at what they are. So here it says the start, stop, and the step. So we can take three arguments, and the step is optional, it looks like, from those square brackets. So you can see here, if the step argument is omitted, it defaults to 1. If the start argument is omitted, it defaults to 0. So by default, if you just give it one number, 10 like that, we're gonna get a range of numbers from 0 up to, but not including 10. that is 10 different numbers. If we give two numbers, it will start at that first number and then go all the way up to, but not including the second number. So there I get a range from 1 to 10 inclusive by doing that. And by giving a third argument, I can specify the step size. So here I go from 0 to 30, counting up by 5 each time. So let's put that documentation into practice using for loops. And here when I run those cells, you can see that happening in my code. We can get even more control over the flow of the code within the for loop by using a few particular keywords which are defined in Python. One of them is the break keyword. And what this does is it's going to exit the loop as soon as the code reaches that break keyword. So in this example here, once the loop reaches 20, the break statement is going to be hit and the loop is going to be broken out of, and it will just continue and run all the code outside of the loop beyond that. The parse keyword acts as a placeholder when you might be working on new code and you don't know what's going to go there yet, but you don't want to have any syntax errors. So if we didn't have this here, we'd get an indentation error. So yeah, we can use that when we're still developing, thinking about implementation. It basically corresponds to do nothing when you have the parse keyword. It's just a line which will fix any indentation and do nothing. And we might see some more useful use cases for that later. The difference between continue and break is that break is not going to run any more iterations, whereas continue is going to go to the next iteration. There's some other useful built-in methods in Python, zip and enumerate, and both of them are pretty useful when you're working with for loops, so I want to show those now. The zip function zips two sequences together, pairing the item in each corresponding index and returning a tuple of them. So here we're using the zip function in Python. You can see it returns a list of tuples. You can use this in a for loop when you want to loop through two iterables simultaneously. The zip function also means you can unpack the tuples in the for loop. And in this example, you can get similar to what we use when we use the items method to iterate through dictionary key value pairs. Enumerate is another really useful built-in function like zip. But instead of passing in two iterators, you just pass in one. And what it's going to do is it's going to zip that iterator with indexes which correspond to which index in the iteration that item is in the position of. So the number assigned to each element is the iteration number, starting at 0, and that continues up until we've got the end of the list. One common thing you might want to do is append items to a list in sequence. So let's say we want to create a list where each item is the cube of another iterable of 10 numbers. So this example, we've got an empty list, and then the code goes through a loop from 1 to 10, and at each iteration, we append the cube of each element in the range to the empty list. There's a much more Pythonic and efficient way of doing this, and that's using a list comprehension. So a list comprehension is basically all of this in one line. So here you can see that a list comprehension is defined using the square brackets, just like a regular list. So the first thing you find in the list comprehension is the expression which is going to be returned for each item in this list. And then you have the for keyword, and then you have a placeholder variable name, which can be whatever you want. And that's going to be a variable which represents the value of the current item in the iterable which you're iterating through. Similar to regular for loops, you've also got to have this in keyword. And finally, you've got to specify what it is you want to iterate through. Once you're used to this, I'm sure you get really comfortable working with them, and you'll find that there's a lot of places where you can make your code look a lot better and keep it much more compact. And a common way that you can use list comprehensions in the same way that we've used here is wherever you want to map one iterable to another. So here, this is basically the map operation where I've mapped a list of integers into a list of their cubes. But you've got to be careful because you can't use a list comprehension everywhere you can use a loop. That's because, as I mentioned, the first thing in a list comprehension has got to be an expression. It can't be a statement, so you can't have any for loops or variable assignments in there. It needs to all be one thing which resolves to a value, and that's the value that each item in the iterable is going to take on. You can also create set comprehensions by replacing the square brackets with curly brackets. So we know that with a set, it's going to just contain unique items without any order. Very similar to a list comprehension there. The next thing you can do is create dictionary comprehensions. The difference here is that instead of expression, I've got a key value pair, as with regular dictionaries, separated by a colon. So you might think that by replacing the square brackets with parentheses, you'd create a tuple comprehension. But in fact, that's actually not the case. What that's going to do is going to create a generator, and we're going to save that for later to talk about. So to finish off here, let's take a look at a special case of loops, nested loops. Nested loop is just one loop inside another loop. The inner loop is going to finish iterating over all the elements before the outer loop iterates through its first item. So you can see the output y has to iterate through all the range from 0 to 3 before x can loop through its next iteration. So that's everything I'm going to go through regarding for loops right there. And they're going to be one of the main tools you use in Python, so you'll be seeing them all the time. So make sure to get real comfortable with them. But let's just kind of review what I've gone through there. So a few of the key points were obviously how to create a loop that iterates through a sequence of items, how to create a loop that iterates through a set of code specific amount of times using the range built-in function, and also saw some special keywords to introduce: break, continue, and pass. We saw the zip and the enumerate built-in methods, which are really useful. And we saw making list, dictionary, comprehensions, and other comprehensions. They can be a bit more efficient, improve readability, and just kind of a useful, nice tool that you can use in Python. And the very last thing that I covered there was just an example of nested loops, which are super common as well. But a lot of the time, you want to avoid them because they can be very time expensive.